So it's body shot.
Play it, voice is makkelijk, right? Play makkelijk. I want to talk to you, Andre. The boys can decide what they want. I'm easy, all right? They play the ball, so we play rugby. They don't, and they face the music I give them. All right? All right. Come here, Ethan. Back is yours.
So body shot has been sent off the field for arguing with Andre Watson.
Back is yours.
So now what is going to happen? Buddy Swat is being sent off, I think, for continuous argument by Andre Watson, and they're losing 10 metres now, and things are really going awry now. So Andre Force is going to have to send one of the loose forwards off.
This is why you do not argue with the referee. You are going to get a red card. And where did he even get the red card from? Did he pickpocket the referee? Gents, come on, please. At least we don't see a lot of those incidents anymore. Welcome back to Phaka, our second segment, as we continue our look and celebration of the top referees in the country. We're joined in studio by Shaun Veldsman, SA Rugby TMO referee, Makaya Jack, and Alfred Mzizi, still in studio as well. Shaun, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much.
When you see incidents like that, you don't even have to come in. You'd probably laugh.
Yeah, I'd probably laugh at that. still very much fresh,
yes,
in my memory.
Yes. How did you get into the world of rugby?
Into the world of rugby, I actually started refereeing back in the old days, still when it was still SARU. When we were still divided, just before 1992. Hmm. That's when I started, and I started refereeing in the old Southwestern districts. Rugby union, and then I stopped for a couple of years because I became involved in administration of club, because I'm from Robertson, and then I was the secretary there, and then I started refereeing seriously in 1997 again, and then that's when I actually started moving up the ranks. Mm. And then 2003 refereed the Currie Cup final, then straight after that I refereed Super 12 rugby back then. And then because of an injury, leg injury, knee injury, back in 2006, I then in 2006, middle 2006, I started full-time TMO. Mm. Yeah.
In 2003, that was like your big match, your TV match moment, the big one. How did you prepare for that game, the butterflies going into that match?
Yeah, it was quite interesting. I can still remember. I got a call from our referees manager back then, Fred Berger. In 2003, that Saturday evening, telling me that, listen, you need to keep this quiet, but you're refereeing the final next week between the Bulls and the Sharks.
Wow.
So that was, and I couldn't say anything to anybody. So that was quite still excited. So for the whole week, Freek and I worked together, do some fitness, test knowledge and stuff, just by the basic stuff. Because we didn't have to do a lot of preparation, but I was quite adamant early in the year that I was going to referee the Currie Cup final. Because when I had a look at the 2003 rugby schedule for World Cup rugby, I realized that all the top referees that we currently had at that stage, they were going to be out of the country. And then there's going to be an opportunity for me to focus on what I want to do at the end of the year.
On that big moment.
On that big moment. I can still remember I was on the plane to Sydney with Craig Joubert. Yeah. And myself, and opening the newspaper, and I said, listen, look here, look at the schedule here. I said, listen, I think I'm going to do the Currie Cup final. And it happened like that.
I need to ask him.
From your mouth,
he must have smoke called. He must have smoke called.
Nice spice there.
Shawnee, as a TMO, I just want to see you, from you, I just want to imagine the pressure when a referee in the frame, when he's referring a certain infringement, what kind of a pressure do you have to endure? Let's say it's a critical moment, the last minute of the game, and all that kind of stuff. What comes into your mind with all that kind of pressure?
I think it's immense, to put it mildly, that it's quite difficult because you know that a lot of eyes are now focused on you. Mm. And we have currently in South Africa and all over the world, we've got millions and millions of TMOs. in the world, because they also think that they can get this call right. Right? Mm. So, and then here I sit and I have to look at reviews and reviews and reviews, and depending on the director and what he shows me, I have to make that decision. But you need to completely isolate yourself from everybody and sit and focus on what it is that you need to do. Focus on the incident in front of you. I think that's important. Otherwise, you're going to get it wrong if you get emotionally too much involved in the game. So that's when you... I normally do that. When I walk into that little booth of mine, I cut myself off. It's like there's nothing there around me. It's only me and this TV in front of me. So, but we have to deal with it. We have to deal with it.
So, Shaun, it has to do with a lot of mental preparation before that the game. So is there any routine that you have to go under before that you take your desk that in the cubicle?
Yeah. We do a lot of prep during the week up to the build-up for the game on Saturday. Mm-hmm. We've got a system that we call the AMS system, mm-hmm. that we, where we can actually go on and actually review games or whatever games we want to review, or we can review incidents or TMO calls of the previous weekends, whatever we want to. So we do that during the game, during the week, sorry. Mm-hmm. And then also what the referee does is that he would send us his presentation or his preparation also for the game that's coming. Mm-hmm. And then we look at that also to what he wants to achieve, his goals for the game, mm-hmm. and how close we get actually to that. Mm-hmm. So we do a lot of reviews during the whole week. And then obviously we have our meetings, our general meetings that we have as a team of four, so that we can see what it is that we want to do during this game. And I can tell you, we discuss teams. We discuss certain behavior mm-hmm. of certain...
culprits too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we discuss mm-hmm. that as well. Mm-hmm. And it's not that we focus on that, but it is just for us to be aware mm-hmm. of what we... Yeah. of maybe what we can expect.
Mm-hmm. Do you review the teams that are going to be on the field on the day? So if it's Mutsidisi FC versus Makaya FC, in your reviews, are you looking at my old games or my team's old games and Makaya's team's old games?
Correct.
Are you?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. And so we do everything. We do scrums, lineouts, offsides, penalties, rucks, mauls, TMO calls. We do everything.
So, Shaun, going to the game, you've got an idea that if Mercedes FC come into the scrummage, they tend to be ill-disciplined. So when you get there, you know exactly when you're in this area, anything that could happen. Now, my question that will be that to you. That in this case decided they've played positive that on that the 22 area, and then incident that happened that in the really trying time, that I mean, how do you feel that of that when you are the one that make that the call and your referee that miss it out?
When we make those kind of calls, the calls must be clear and obvious. CNO, that's what we're talking about. Mm-hmm. So it's not something that the referees... I know that a lot of people think that the referees and TMOs, we guess. We do a lot of guessing on the field, but that's not the case. Mm. Because we very much on the incident, on the infringement, because it must be clear and obvious for everybody. Actually, everybody sitting in the stand actually to see, listen here, oh, that actually did happen.
Yeah, I hear you, Shaun, because as a referee, it boils down about decisions. Mm. Mm. It's a decision-making. It's a decision execution. Now, at the end of the day, you have to make a call as a TMO. Who has the final say between you as the main ref on the field and you in your cubicle in a very touch-and-go situation? Let's say it's a touch-and-go situation and we are on the 82nd minute. Mm. Let's put it. Mm. Now, it's a crunch decision at the 82nd minute. Mm. Now, you have seen... You've made reviews, because what the referee does, the referee says, Shaun, I've seen this and this and this and this and this and this. Can you please find out this a try or no try? Mm.
Okay, so it depends on, I just want to say, in the 82nd minute, the game should have been finished already. it should have been done. so let's make it in the 79th minute. Sounds better.
If the momentum goes beyond the 80th minute, the new rule allows. Yeah. Now you can kick the ball and play that line out. Let's assume it's in that situation.
So I understand exactly what you say. So it depends what the situation is. So whether it's in goal, so that is my almost want to say my field of decision making. I take the lead. I lead the conversation, right? But if it's something that happens in the field of play, in goal to in goal, right? That's where the referee, and it's foul play. The referee must actually lead that conversation.
All right.
And then he must make the decision, depending on what the situation is. So, but if something, if it's something that I have, for example, I have spotted foul play sitting up, then I've seen it, then I must lead that. Then I must lead that conversation, and I must say, listen here, this is what I've seen, and it's deemed potential foul play. It's not definitely foul, but it's deemed potential foul play. So then we have to look at it, and if the referee can't make a decision on field where he sees the big screen, then I make the decision and he goes with my decision, right? If it's something that he can see on the big screen and he wants to make a decision, but I don't agree with what he is going to do, then I've got the right also to say, I disagree with what you're going to do. I think the outcome should be this. And then he can change his decision as well.
Now, that means, Shaun, that means I heard this man speaking about mental toughness. And before you become mental tough, you have to be spiritually tough.
Mental preparation.
Do you guys, before getting to the... Do you pray?
Come on,
Shaun.
Come
yes.
On.
The guys do. Yeah, I do.
Yeah. Collectively.
Yeah. So you know what? In South Africa, it's a big thing. The guys who would normally would form a little circle and they would say a little prayer, like the rugby players would do, right? But if you go overseas to other nations and you visit other countries and stuff like that, then you don't get those kind of situations where match officials will actually form a circle and pray. But in South Africa, it does happen. I can assure you. I can assure you.
This is my friend, Mort. Yeah.
You must also pray for him.
I pray always. He comes to my booth.
Before we move on, I would love to know, a try scored.
Yeah.
It looks like a try. And then your fly half runs with the ball under his shoulder. It's going. I'm going to kick over the conversion. How much time between try and conversion does the ref have to go upstairs? Because sometimes we're all celebrating, yay, the game is done. And then all of a sudden, TMO, maybe let's say 20, 30 seconds after the fact. Should it be an immediate reaction? Or does the ref have enough breathing room to say, I'm not quite sure?
Okay, so what happens in a situation like that? So if the try has been scored, and as the referee walks back, I will talk to him, or he would say to me, just check that one. So I would, and if I suspect that something dubious happened, I would ask the producer, just do a quick replay on that. Forget about the crowd shots, everything, do a replay quickly. And we have to do it just before the conversion is being taken. So sometimes it's a minute, it takes a minute because the kickers, they normally take long. They've got about 90 seconds to take that kick. So as he walks back and he's standing there, I can come in and say, Yaku, or I can say, JD, check. So whether it's 30 seconds, 40 seconds, it's irrelevant, right? It depends on how quickly I can get that shot from the producer to show that there was something wrong, actually.
Heartbreak. For most fans, that's just heartbreak. other highlights, of course, of your career, the 2015 Rugby World Cup final. Big, big match as well. What was that like for you? And a difference in preparation from your days as a referee on the park in 2003, right to sitting in that cubicle.
Yeah, it was actually fantastic going to 25th, because I went to the 2011 World Cup as well in New Zealand, where I had to do the semi-final back then. And then actually in 2015, when I did the World Cup final, it was immense, because that whole week, you were like in anticipation. You don't know what was going to happen, because there were four TMOs. So two TMOs, the one was from New Zealand and the other one was from Australia. So
we knew
they were out. They can't do that one. So it left me with another guy from England. So England not having actually a person there, I think Wayne Barnes was part of it. For me, it was actually very exciting. It was heartbreaking.
And the call as well.
Yeah.
The call almost changed the game, actually.
Yeah.
After this, Australia were coming back nicely against New Zealand.
Yeah. So that was. I can't remember. I think I gave a yellow card there. I gave a yellow card for that one. Yeah. That's unfortunate, but it happens.
Yeah.
You have to make those decisions irrespective of which game you're actually in.
Shaun, just on that case, you lift a guy. Yeah. And he doesn't go with his shoulder, with his head and all that kind of stuff. Maybe he goes with his side again. Do you still give a yellow card?
So it depends very much on how the person lands. So if your legs are through the horizontal like we...
And you go straight.
But you go straight, like on your head or on your neck, then that will be red. Straight.
But if a guy landed
on his side, so it was still like legs through the horizontal, landed on his side, not dangerously, so yellow card.
I was also about to say, because it comes instantly, immediately that they take up your legs and lie, the player that he thinks of protecting himself, but the intention of the tackler, it was to stop the play.
Yeah.
That's, I mean, as an old coach, stop the game, not the man, but... Once again, most of the time, I really do compliment that for the work that you're doing there on this. Yeah.
Well, thank you so much, Shaun. Thank you so much for joining us. And congratulations on all of your accolades so far. We really appreciate your time today. And we're going to continue our conversation regarding referees. And know, guys, that the law is the law. But even the referees sometimes get stuck in the play and get injured as well.
Sets the highest of standards, Nick Evans. And this is a kick that's charged down. And Tom Guest put the ball directly into the face of our referee. How much think of it?
Did well to stay on his feet, to be honest.
Not sure he can feel his lips.
Great charge down.